Thank you, Trick and Randy. Praise God for the ministry. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to the house of our God. I pray that Sunday is the greatest day of the week for you. We say frequently it is a gift that God gave to us, right?
Yes.
Thank God for it, because we need times of meditation. We need times of repentance. Amen. We need times of solace, of sanctuary. And he will never fail us. And he is always there for us. I even thank God for moments of repentance because, you know, most times we do just have to change the way we think. We have our minds set in a certain direction, or sometimes our minds are filled with so many things, you know. You ever get to a place in life sometimes where it's just hard to shut your minds off? Like it's time to go to sleep, so you lay in your bed and you turn out your light, but that's the best you can do because you're not sleeping yet. And the mind just keeps going. And I pray that God gives us these times of solace, perhaps repentance, where we realize some of the things that we think about and care about really don't matter much. Amen, everybody. And what matters is the things of God. So I'm grateful for this gift that we have. You know, if you look into your bulletins today and you see the title of our conversation, I'd like to talk to you for a few minutes in regard to the mysteries of God, the mysteries of the Bible, the mysteries that God wants to reveal to us. So maybe we'll have a series, you know, maybe we'll go for a few months in regard to uncovering the mysteries. Because the Bible does speak about many mysteries. You might recall some of the mysteries that are in the Bible. One of the greatest mysteries I think we'll talk about today is the mystery of godliness.
Yes.
We also look in the Bible and you ever hear about the mystery of iniquity. Does that one ever stump you? Sometimes you read the Bible will tell you about the mystery of faith or the mystery of the Son of God. You read the book of Revelation, it tells you the mystery of the stars and the mystery of the lampstands. Of course, we have the mystery of the gospel. Does any of these intrigue you at all? Do you want them? Do you desire them? Do you want to know the things of God? I don't know. But God does, and God says, you want to know the things of God. You want to uncover the mysteries of heaven. The Bible talks about the mystery of Christ and the mystery of his will. The invisible realm is the truest realm. It's the real realm. It's what governs everything that is. And sometimes we get caught up with the physical realm of life and we forget what governs the physical aspects of life. And it is God. It is the kingdom. It is church on Sunday, if you will. It is repentance. It is the mysteries of heaven. And God wants to give us this gift. So even as, you know, we talk about the mysteries of God, I have written down a definition of what the mystery is. And a mystery is a secret which cannot be understood without God's revelation. The things in the Bible you will never understand unless God so chooses to open your eyes. We talked a little bit about this in our Bible study on Friday. But there must be something to precipitate that. Like what causes God to open up my eyes? How come you see something and I don't? Or perhaps I see something and you don't? And I believe it's all birthed in desire, quite honestly. As we opened it up on Friday, it's like if you want God, you can have him. That's a real quiet house. that's a surprisingly quiet house. The Bible says stuff like this. The kingdom of God is asking and seeking and knocking. And I don't know where you are sometimes. Sometimes you don't even ask for the things of God. Sometimes you don't even desire them. But sometimes you do. And sometimes you do go past the asking and you really have an earnest heart and you seek the things of God. Usually, unfortunately, I guess, it takes hard times in our lives to really pursue God. Because I would say most of the times we pursue God in our hard times.
Yes.
When you're overwhelmed with life, then you need him.
Yes.
When you experience tragedy or crisis, then you'll look for him.
Yes.
Then you want him.
Yes.
But when you have other desires and other plans, things that run around in your mind that keep you up at night, because I want to do this and I want to do that, and it has nothing to do with the kingdom of heaven, just a lot to do with our busy lives, God will most definitely bring us to a point where we will seek the kingdom of God. Ask, seek, what's that last one? Knock, knock, knock. Yeah. Because if it seems like God don't hear you and he ain't answering, don't leave. You keep knocking on that door. Anybody got a knock, knock in them? No, knock, knock, joke. You got a knock, knock in you. Anybody want to stand at that door and knock? You ever go to somebody's house and you really don't want to go to their house, but you're obligated to go to their house? So you don't really give a good knock on the door. You give it like a little. And you don't really wait too long. You're 2 seconds and you're in the car and down the block. Now, I know none of you honest people would ever do that. But sometimes these are my business practices, and I go to my customer's house, and I really don't want to see them. So I just give a little tap, 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 and I say, I was there. I left my card. And some of you are tap, tap, tapping at that door, and you're leaving your card and said, Lord, I showed up. You just didn't get to the door on time. But God knows. He's looking at you through the window. Some of you need to go back and ring that bell. And then if you don't answer the bell, knock on that window. And then go around the house and check all the windows and say, Lord, I know you're in there. How bad do you want him? Because sometimes you don't want him so bad. But the truth of the matter is, you always need him so bad. But we don't know that. We don't believe that. I'm trapped in this lie that I live as if this physical world matters so much, and it don't matter so much. No, it doesn't. And that's why you need Sunday or whatever day you have to meditate. You need a God time. You need a God time where you shut the world out. And you say, and you come to a place perhaps of repentance, and you say, Father, forgive me because I have neglected you. I have neglected the Sabbath. The Sabbath is not Sunday. The Sabbath is your time alone with him, if you will. Yes. It is the Lord's day. Doesn't he get one? Doesn't he get one? Yes, I'm going to ask again. Doesn't he get one? Doesn't he get one? Does he ever get two? Does he ever get three? Does he ever get all seven? Some of you say, yes. Amen. Yeah, he gets them all. I was talking to Mark the other day at Bible study, and he said what he would do at times. I hope you don't mind me sharing, but it's too late now. He would take a rock and put it outside on the side of his bed. So he remembered when he got up every morning, the first thing he did is get down on his knees and pray. Amen. Yeah, amen. Sometimes the simple practices are the good reminders. You know, when you said that, Mark, it's like, I don't know if I'm going to put a rock at my bed, but I need the first thing to do is just crawl out and land on my knees. Yeah, and start the day like that, right? How about that, right? Right, everybody? Does that stir you? Does that stir you? Does that stir you towards God? Man, there are mysteries that are greater than all of the mysteries of the earth. You ever watch programs about unsolved mysteries or the mysteries of the earth? Man, there are mysteries of heaven that God wants to disclose, and we're just tapping on that door and running away without even anybody answering that door. I say, why don't you stay a while? I say, why don't you knock again and just a little bit harder until somebody comes to the door? Amen, everybody. For behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man would open the door and answer, he says, I will come in and sup with him. There will be a reward for you if he does knock a little longer, everybody. Amen. Why don't you start the day with me with 1 Corinthians. You got your Bibles? Let's turn to 1 Corinthians. I want to talk about the mysteries of God. Today is just an introduction. But I think as the weeks pass by, we're going to pick out one of the mysteries and open them up. We're going to go mystery by mystery. We're going to have the uncovering of the mysteries. So in 1 Corinthians 4, 1 through 5, Paul here again. And Paul says this, "Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ," and what does that say after that? "And stewards," say it with me, "stewards of the mysteries of God." What are we, everybody? We are stewards of the mysteries of God. Okay. "Moreover, it is required in stewards that one be found faithful." Christ is the faithful one in you. "But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. In fact," some of us need to practice this more, "I do not even judge myself, for I know nothing against myself. Yet I am not justified by this, but it is he who judges me. He who judges me is the Lord." "Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsel of the hearts. Then each one's praise will come from the Lord." Amen. The word of the Lord, everybody. Let's take a look at this passage. This is how one should regard us. Look at how Paul writes this letter here. He says very simply, and it can be misinterpreted, but he says very simply, "Let a man consider us." If you read just, how many words is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If you read those first six words, it says, "Let a man consider us." That could seem like a boastful thing. You know, "Let a man consider us. You guys should consider me." Like Paul saying, you can consider who I am, know who I am, but it's not really what it's saying. Paul says, "Let a man consider us" what? "As servants." Paul is saying, I'm a nobody here. If you want to consider me a servant of Christ. And you know that this word, it could also indicate a slave. And Paul says, I am a slave to Christ. He says, if you want to consider me anything, consider me to be a servant to Christ. And I am so fascinated. I say the Sunday in the church house is a time for repentance. I say, let us always repent and find God. In this passage, I look at Paul. Paul was like the greatest apostle that lived. He was the one that traveled the world. You want to talk about these world travelers? He was a world traveler. He traveled to the ends of the world that was known. He went to Rome, and he went to, some say, even Spain, the end of the world that was currently known. Wow. And he said, that I am nothing, I'm nobody, I'm a servant of Christ. Do not regard me as somebody important. He says, regard me as a servant, just he is sent by God to do his will. And I say, let us repent and understand and have this mind, the mind that was in Christ, let it so be in us. Because so many times we just puff ourselves up. We want to deem ourselves to be important, more important than we should. We deem ourselves to have more value than other people around us, like people should serve us, where God says, no, you should serve others. I think of some of the church scene today and some of the church leaders that we see today, and a Christian leader isn't supposed to be a big shot, everybody. A Christian leader isn't supposed to be a CEO, isn't supposed to be a spiritual celebrity. Paul, who could have been the greatest spiritual celebrity, he could have went on tour. He could have called himself CEO, apostle, bishop, father of fathers, whatever. He could have written all his books and signed his things and wore his $3,000 suits to go on tour. and expected all of his parishioners to bow before him and call him sir. And the people, I don't have time for the people, keep them from me. I will only visit a few at a time, but I'm a very important man. I'm a man of God on a mission. And we have polluted the ministry of Christ. Amen. And let us therefore repent. For Paul said, if you want to consider me a servant, a slave of Christ. Consider me a prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you want to consider me to be anything, consider me to be nothing for the cause of Christ. Amen. And therefore he would say at the end of his life, I know what it's like to be rich and I know what it's like to be poor. I could have a lot or I could have nothing. It don't matter what I got. Because my life is not about what I got and what I'm getting. It's about serving Jesus Christ. And he said, I've been in prison many times, and I've been shipwrecked many times, and I've been beaten many times, because I am a servant of Christ. Never mind this religious garbage we have in our culture today that says, bow down before me. I'm a big shot. Bow down before me. Have this mind. And have the mind that was in Christ. Let this mind, therefore, be also in you. And if anyone deems themselves to be great, Christ, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, would say, then let him be the servant of all. Amen, everybody. Amen, everybody. Paul, a servant of Christ. That alone is enough to cause us to come into the church house and repent. We could bow. So many times we should just bow before God and cry and repent because we have taken the things of God and making them something that they're not. We have used the things of God to promote ourselves, to say that we're important and prosperous and successful. And we care nothing of the poorness around us, of the brokenness around us, of the true Christ that we are to serve. Right. And we get lost in this life of success, and that's what keeps you up at night. It isn't the Christ, because the Christ would cause you to sleep and to sleep well. Amen. Yeah, that's a good amen right there. Amen. That's a good amen, because he gives his beloved sleep. Yes, he does. Amen. So if you ain't sleeping at night, maybe we got to repent a little bit. Maybe I'm chasing after things I shouldn't chase. Maybe I want some things too much that I shouldn't want so much. Because we got things, but maybe we just want them too much and desire them too much and pursue them too much at the cost of Christ. Amen, everybody. Maybe we need to repent a little bit more. Sometimes we get so grown up and so mature and so sophisticated, we forget what it's like just to get down on your knees and cry and say, Father, forgive me. Forgive me for living this vain, selfish life. Amen. Amen. Paul, a servant of Christ. What else, though? Yeah, a servant of Christ and a steward of the mysteries of God. Amen, everybody. So, I believe that there's something small and there's something great in that. Thanks for keeping that verse up, Keith. I believe there's something small and there's something great in that little verse. First, God says, and Paul says, you're a servant. But as a servant, he says this, you are stewards of all of the riches of heaven. Isn't that extraordinary? On the one end, you're just a servant. On the other end, you are in charge of all of the riches of the universe. Isn't that like an oxymoron? It's going to take a servant to be in charge of the riches of the universe. It will take a servant's heart. Otherwise, you will not distribute them properly. You'll probably keep them all for yourself. Nobody else will get any unless you are a true servant. Amen, everybody. Because when you're not a true servant, you keep it for yourself. And you just want to make sure everybody else knows that you're great and rich and prosperous and successful. Somehow you were not a good steward and you did not give it out. Because if you got all that, that means you're not a good steward. A steward means whatever you got, you give it away. And if you still got it, you're a bad steward. Because a steward's supposed to give it away, not keep it. Amen, everybody. Amen, everybody. Amen, everybody. Oh, man, we can go down that road, but not today. Not today. So in that same verse, he says, I'm a servant, but I am also in charge of all of the riches of the universe. How about that? And so are you. And so are you. We are the people of God upon this earth. We are stewards of the mysteries of God. And we don't even value that we are stewards of the mystery of God. We think it's more valuable to be stewards of these corporations. Well, I'm a CEO, and I'm a FTS, and I'm a LMNP, and I'm... I'm sorry, I don't know the corporate world. Phil, was that any of them right, Phil? Thank God he sent Phil into that corporate world, because I couldn't do it. But Pastor Phil does it well. He brings Christ to them. Amen, brother? Amen, amen, brother. Amen. Yeah, I don't have the patience. Phil would say, I don't have the sophistication, the smarts. Praise the Lord, everybody. We are stewards of the mysteries of heaven. You know, I think God, man, there's a couple of things on these pieces of paper, but it doesn't even really matter. God just wants to give us the truth, man. We don't even know who we are. We run after things because we don't know what we got. Man, and then we're all tempted to grab that carrot, that golden apple, if you will, because we don't know who we are. We don't know. Like, God shows you, out of all the people that's in Lehi and Fort Myers, he chose you to sit in here today to hear this message. You are the chosen of God. Chosen of God. And he wants to tell you, I have the mysteries of heaven for you. What you possess, the world would sell everything they got. It's like the man who's looking for the kingdom. And when he finally found the kingdom of heaven, he went and he sold all that he had because he found what was truly valuable. And unless you have a revelation of what's truly valuable, you're going to hold on to all your empty junk until you realize that Christ is the prize. And when you realize that Christ is the prize, you'll go home one day, you'll go home and you'll sell it all, everything that you live and breathe for, you'll throw it away when you truly find what's valuable and what's precious and what matters in this life. What matters in this life, everything else will become nothing to you. You won't even sell it, you'll just throw it in the garbage. Because Paul said, I count it all as, yeah, dung. rubbish. Huh. I would give all that rubbish away if I could just have one of the mysteries of God. Just give me one of the mysteries of God. Something this world has no idea about. Give me the mystery of godliness, for great is the mystery of godliness, and it is without controversy. There is nothing greater than the mystery of godliness upon this earth, within this universe, within all of creation. That's right. That's right, everybody. Yes, you are a servant, but you're also steward of the greatest riches ever known to mankind. So the steward was the overseer of an estate. He was the manager, the administrator. The reason why God gives you things, everybody, if you ever wonder why God gives you things, it's not so you can count it every week and see, watch it grow. So you can give it away. And there's a mystery to that, because when you give it away, guess what God does? Yeah, he gives you more, son of a gun. You ever try that one? No? All right. Try it. A steward, oh Lord, I got to go there, man. A steward is not the one who acquires wealth and adds it up and keeps measuring it and counting it. A steward is the one, as soon as you get it, you are eager to give it away. You're not getting it for yourself. You're getting it to give away. Why is this in my hands at this time? Who does it belong to? You ever receive something in such a matter where you just know it wasn't for you? You ever receive something, whether it was financial or whatever? You ever just get something in your hands like, I know this is not for me. Like, it felt holy. It seemed holy. Like, I know this is not for me. And you just held it for a minute until that situation came. Oh, it's for you. And then you just took it and give it to whoever came in your path. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. We are stewards of it. We are stewards of it. A steward of heaven is the one who just gives everything away and somehow always has enough. We're the people of God. We are the people of the mysteries of heaven. Amen. Who understands this? The people of God understand this. You understand this. I understand this, and it makes no sense to the world, to the reasonable, to the wisdom of this world. It makes no sense, because the wisdom of this world teaches you to take care of yourself above all else. Take care of yourself now and make sure you take care of yourself in your old age. Well, what if you just had faith instead of 401? What if you just had faith? I don't know if my brother's laughing with me or at me sometimes. He's saying, you sucker. I don't need a 401. My brother has one. I'll be fine. That's why I got the last laugh. I'm fine. I've been fine for a long time. Because he is a good steward. Because he is a good steward. I pray that that truth alone, because we're so, sinks into our spirits, we're so bombarded with the lie of success, of acquiring, of adding. Isn't it in the Bible, the simple things, isn't it in the Bible that rich man that said he had lots of stuff, right? And then he got more stuff. So what did he do? He said he had small barns. He said, I'm going to build bigger barns now so I can hold all of my stuff. God forbid he give it away. He just built bigger barns so he can keep all his stuff. That's us. We believe the lie, and then we measure it, and then we compare it. How many barns you got? I got two barns and a shed. Uh-huh. I just got a shed. And then, you know, the interesting thing is you go down the roads and you see all these storage units, storage units, storage units, storage units, and they're quite successful. My brother and I were going to open up a storage unit one time. Thank God we never did. Because we got so much stuff, we don't know what to do with it, so we put it in storage units. And we don't visit it, we just know that it's there. Oh, it keeps us up at night. Oh, my stuff. Oh, I have my stuff. Oh. You never use it. I'll tell you something else. Some of you who have money in your accounts, listen, all you got is black digits on a white piece of paper. There's a million of people out there with need, and you just look at, oh, I got my black numbers on my white paper. Let me check it again. It's still there. Oh, praise Jesus. You got nothing, man. I don't know who's got it, but you got nothing but black digits on a white piece of paper. The kingdom of heaven, everybody. There's a passage, and I want to read this passage to you. We'll take a look at this one, guys. Luke 16:11. Take a look at this. Take a look. You know this one? Therefore, if you have not been faithful with unrighteous mammon, this passage is talking about money, your money. Talking about my money, talking about your money. If you have not been faithful with unrighteous mammon, that's what God calls your money. He calls your money unrighteous mammon. It's alive, all right, because mammon means something that's alive. Your money is alive. Oh, my goodness, it has the power, my God, to make you happy and sad, to make you jump and make you sink. It's alive, all right. Our money is more powerful than we know. But the Bible calls it unrighteous mammon, and he gives it to us as a test or what have you. And he says, if you have not been faithful with unrighteous mammon, who will commit to you your trust? Who will commit to your trust true riches? And the true riches is what we're talking about today. It's the mysteries of the kingdom of God. It's the mysteries of God, which are the true riches. But first he says, if we're not faithful with unrighteous mammon, and you know the preceding passage, it tells you what the steward did. There was a guy who was a steward of his boss's money, and he did something that his boss found him to be faithful in dealing with the money. And really what he did was, with his boss's money, he made friends. He built relationships. He forgave debts. That's what he used money for. Money is the power of God in your hands to forgive, to build relationships, to heal people. That's the power of money. It's not for you to buy and to sell and to acquire and to count. If God gives you money, it's to touch people's lives. It's to make a difference in the world. It's to forgive sins. It's to forgive debts, if you will. It's to heal. It's to build relationships. Money is the power to build relationships. And how did he do that? He did it by giving it away. That's the power of money. Uh-huh. The power of money is to touch people's lives. And God will show you how to use that money to touch people's lives. Amen?
Amen.
Yes, he will. Sometimes you want to have impact in somebody's life. Sometimes the greatest impact, if you attach it to some money, you will move that person because you don't care about that money, but that person needs that money. And God will use it as a tool. This guy, he used money as a tool. The reason why he was found faithful with money, not because he saved it and counted it, and at the end of his life he had a little nest egg. No, that was not the faithful one of money. The one who was faithful was the one who gave it away. And he says, if you're faithful with money, then I'll trust you with true riches. If you're faithful to give it away,
amen,
to touch lives, to help people, then he'll give you true riches.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. And the true riches is heaven. It's the mysteries of God. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And I pray that we would be found faithful with this unrighteous mammon. This is our prayer. So how does God, how do you get God to give you the mysteries of heaven? Here's another way. Be faithful with the unrighteous stuff. Use it to touch lives. And always at your expense, right? It's not really a true gift unless it pinches a little bit, you know? You know, I was talking with the guys at work today, and we came across a similar scenario about the woman who bought a new piano, and she called church, and she talked to the pastor and said, "Pastor, I have a new piano. I'd like to donate my old piano to the church." And the pastor says, "I don't want your old piece of junk, broken down piano." He said, "Give me your new one." And she repented of heart. She gave the church a new one.
Amen.
Don't give people your junk. Yes. Your leftover junk. Give them your best. And be found a faithful steward of life. Of life. Amen, everybody.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. We're so lost in this world, everybody. I know we leave the church house on a Sunday, and we're still thinking about our jobs, whether we can perform them or not perform them, whether we can make the money to pay the bill, to fulfill our dream, maybe just to feed our children. And God says life is so much bigger than that. And you're in bondage to this.
Yes.
He says, "I want to show you a mystery. The mysteries of heaven, the mystery of godliness. If the world knew this wisdom, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory, but they do not know this wisdom. It's the wisdom to live a life that's abundant and to pour out into people's lives, knowing that God in turn will pour out into your lives."
Amen.
Amen, everybody. And that you are subject to no man. You are a debtor to no man. You owe no man nothing. You are servants of God, everybody. Don't ever think you're a servant of man. You are not a servant. I don't care how much money they think that you owe them. You serve no man. And you owe no man. Sometimes we get stuck in our false integrity and religious garbage and pretense. The only one you owe anything to is God Almighty.
Amen.
And let everybody else wait at the door. Amen, everybody. Yeah, that's it. We don't know the mysteries of God, and God says you're chasing all of this garbage because you don't know the mysteries of heaven. The mysteries of heaven are profound. They're past finding out. It is stronger than this world. It is bigger than this world. It is better than this world. And all we want is the world. But Paul said, make no mistake, I am a servant of Christ, and I am a steward of the mysteries of God. Amen. And I will travel this world and give them to anybody who dares to want them.
Yes.
Who dares to want them. Who dares to forsake what is unrighteous to grab onto something that is righteous. Amen. You know, maybe in closing, I want to say this. You know, what exactly are you and I responsible for in this life? I want to remind you, everybody, at least in this house and everybody online, I want to remind you that you are the people of God.
Yes.
Yeah, can we get another amen? We are the people of God. You are not the people of this world. You're special. You're the people of God. You're servants of who, everybody?
God,
Christ. You are servants of no man. Come Monday morning, you are not the servant of man. You're always the servant of God. And therefore, it is a great life. You are a servant of God. And know what your responsibility is as a servant of God. And I've written a couple of things down. But even in a small little passage here, Paul does not say that Christ's ministers are to be stewards of the church, as if though our primary responsibility is to build up these religious institutions. We are not supposed to be stewards of the church. Like we got to ask for money to build these kingdoms. I need more money. I'm building more buildings. Oh, Lord, I could be very on nice right now, you know, and some of the things that I want to say. Because that is not what we've been called to be stewards of. We have not been called to be stewards of the church, of institutions, of buildings, of campuses. We have been called to be stewards of the mysteries of heaven.
Yes.
And it does not cost any money to distribute them.
Yes.
You don't even need a building All you need is people, and they're all over the place. Have you seen them? We are called to be stewards of the mysteries of God. You don't even need a building. You say, give me $10 million, we're going to lose the building. Then lose the building and shut up. And tell me about the mysteries of God, not the mysteries of your financial plan. Tell me something that I'm dying to hear. Tell me something that I need. Stop filling my ears with this nonsense, with this unrighteous mammon. And somebody be a steward of the mystery of God. I say that's you. And it is by the grace of God that we have this building, everybody. God gave us this building. Man wanted to take it away, and I tell you what, Phil and I were trying to help him. It's like, would you take this thing already? But God said, no. God said, no. It is by the grace of God. That's why you will never, ever, ever hear from our mouths this plea for your unrighteous mammon. But we will be dispensers of the mysteries of the kingdom of God all day, every day. And God will create a house to give that out. Yes, he will. He'll do it all by himself. He's that big. He don't need you. But he does love you. Amen, everybody. Isn't that right, brother? Isn't that right, brother? Yeah, that's right. Like it or not, that's right. So we have not been called to be stewards of this religious organization, but of the mysteries of God. Paul does not say that we're stewards of wealth, which is the way that Christians usually explain the concept of stewardship. Usually the church house, when they want to talk about finances, they want to talk about stewardship. And primarily, is everybody still with me? Because I'm having fun here. Primarily, the church house speaks of stewardship. If you want to be a good steward of the money, the Bible never tells you to be a good steward of the money. He says to be a good steward of the mysteries of God, and we're so wrapped up in this stinking money, we can't even dispense the kingdom of heaven. Amen. That's right. And then we have this wrong concept of stewardship. Stewardship has something to do with your money, and if you want to be a good steward, you got to give 10%, and that's just the beginning, everybody, because then there's the first fruits offering, and then after the first fruits offering, there's the second fruits offering, and after the second fruits offering, oh, shut up already. I got no more money left. I had no money walking in. Now, since I ran out of money at the first fruit offering, does that mean I don't get the blessing? Well, you get the partial blessing. Because if you gave the $1,000 seed, you'd get the full blessing. But, you know, I think God still has a little something for you. I have not been called, and neither have you been called, to be stewards of wealth, of money. Manage it well, everybody. According to the gospel, the way you manage your money well is to give it away.
Amen.
Yeah, that's right. So he does not call us to be stewards of that. In this passage here, he doesn't even call us to be stewards of the world, everybody. I say Sunday's a good day to repent, to rethink, to understand who we are and why we are. We need to know who we are and why we are. We are not the people of this world, and we're not called to be stewards of this world. I am not called to be a steward of the earth, a steward of the trees, a steward of the water, a steward of the sky, a steward of the atmosphere. We are not called to be stewards of the world and of the atmosphere. For crying out loud, we are called to be stewards of the mystery of God and the mystery of the gospel. Dispense that, please. Dispense that. As if you have any idea what's going on in the atmosphere. The Lord said, as long as there will be seed time and harvest. There will be winter and fall. God says, as long as the earth remains, there will be the four seasons of the world. There will be seed time and harvest. That's all I need to know. It's his world, and I can't break it. But I am supposed to, and so are you. You're supposed to be a steward of the mysteries of God.
Yes.
Know who you are. You want to give your energy somewhere, your heart somewhere. You want to live by conviction. My goodness, we're the people of God. Everybody, if you are not a steward of the mysteries of God, then who will be? The person that's not sitting here? The person that's not sitting here? The person that didn't even have enough desire, perhaps, to seek him? The person, perhaps, that just tapped on the door and then went away? Well, then no one gets the mysteries. No one gets God then. No one gets God. But God is big enough, he'll work for a few until there's many, right? He'll work through one until there's two. He'll work through two until there's four. But you're all getting the blessing. Because it doesn't count on man, it counts on God. Thank God for that one, everybody. We are not called to be stewards of the environment. No. No, we're called to be stewards of the mysteries of God. The mysteries of God. We end there, everybody. I wanted to go on to the 43 mysteries of heaven, but I don't think I have time for the 43 mysteries of heaven. We are called to be mysteries. We are called to be stewards of the mysteries. Let's end it with this, everybody. You can't be a steward of the mystery if you don't know the mysteries.
Yes.
All the riches of the invisible and visible realm are yours to be dispensed, but you cannot dispense them if you don't know them. So why don't you look for them? Why don't you very simply wake up in the morning, get on your knees or not, and say, Father, yeah, give me the mysteries. What are the mysteries? The greatest mystery of heaven is Christ. The greatest mystery is that God became a man. Christ Jesus is the greatest mystery. God became a man. God became flesh. Let me just tell you a little bit about that mystery, just a little bit. You are the same. You are the same. Because the Christ in you is the hope of glory, everybody. There is a God inside of you that has become flesh and still walks among us today. There's a God inside of you, everybody. Really big, really full. I say let's live like that. Let's uncover it. Let's look for it. Let's desire it. Maybe together we can ask, seek, and knock. I guess my last question is how hard are you gonna knock? And how long are you gonna stay after you knock? All right. God bless you, everybody. Praise and worship team. Tiger Lou, I didn't see you this morning. I would have mentioned your name. God bless you. Let's stand up and look for God, everybody. God bless you all. Amen.